Now, there's been a rise in escalation of incidents from this morning up until now. Joining us now to talk about this further is security analyst Charles Shoebridge, who joins us over the phone. Charles, thank you very much for joining The Bulletin. Now, what is going on in France? Shootings, hostage takings. In your opinion, Charles, will this French security apparatus be able to bring the situation under control, or is this the beginning of more things to come?
I think the short answer is yes. French police and security apparatus, as you call it, and you're right to do so because it's involving far many more agencies than simply the police, including the military, of course, are in a position now where they have two ongoing situations. There could be more that develop, but they've had 2 days to mobilize a vast array of resources, which they've been able to deploy quite effectively and quickly in the latest developments. There are questions, I think, over the speed of the initial response in the first few hours that allowed the two Charlie Hebdo suspects to escape. But nonetheless, they're helped, the French police, now by the fact that these are two static situations, at least as far as we know at the current time. So that, notwithstanding that the position they're in, the police is an unenviable one, because it may result in more casualties still to come, as often is the case with hostage situations. But nonetheless, they do have the resources in place, and I think are able to cope with this from, let's say, a resource point of view.
I mean, have they done well to deal with the second hostage taking, or did they learn from their first mistake, more or less?
The problem is that if you have a situation where your intelligence work fails to predict accurately that an attack or some kind of incident is going to take place, and that appears to have been the situation here, then it's extremely difficult to play catch-up and actually put in place the measures to physically protect targets. And that's particularly the case, of course, when you've got soft targets such as these. For example, we've got a grocery store at the moment. You had journalists, and let's not forget that the Charlie Hebdo premises were guarded by presumably armed police, but of course they were lightly armed, and it made no difference. If your intelligence work fails to that extent, then you've got very little chance of protecting the intended targets. And further down the line, of course, it won't be the priority today, but especially now with some reports I've seen, even that the Algerian security services have reportedly said that they've, or somebody within them has said that they've tipped off French intelligence about this, plus the fact that we know from the Americans and from leaks within the French intelligence services themselves that these people were very well known to the French authorities. Of course, it begs questions as to how they misjudged the level of threat that these people posed and didn't place them under proper surveillance, either electronic or physical surveillance, which, of course, would have given an indication that, A, they were arming themselves, and, B, that they were about to carry out these attacks. But that won't be the priority for the current time. The current time, the situation is, as you've mentioned, to resolve these issues,
Charles,
hopefully not as peaceably as possible.
Yeah, Charles, as we've seen, the reports of another siege is taking place in Paris with hostages. What are the possibility of sleeper cells?
Well, that's, in effect, what we've got here. You've got a situation where a number of people have been radicalised over the years. They will take the opportunity to attack either when they're instructed to or when it suits them from their own initiative. And it may well be the case that, although we know that there are links between these two separate groups that are holding hostages in Paris at the moment, and indeed there may be more than one person holding hostages in the other situation, there may be accomplices elsewhere. But we don't know for certain that this was part of a planned operation involving both groups. It may well be, and this is, if you like, how this kind of jihadist terrorism is very easy to carry out in many ways, because you can, if you like, motivate yourself to actually see, well, hang on, here are my colleagues or former colleagues carrying out an action, an operation, the Charlie Hebdo one. They're now holed up and, of course, could do with some help. And therefore, particularly when you have a philosophy that hinges on martyrdom, where you don't care, in fact, you will welcome death rather than not care about it, that then you can self-start. You can actually just grab your weapons that you've actually secreted away at some point and then go out and carry out your own action in support of what you might see as your brothers in arms. And that seems to be what's happened here. And, of course, that itself makes it, in defense of the intelligence services, actually quite a difficult operation to predict,
right,
if you haven't got these people already under electronic or physical surveillance.
Okay, we're just going to have to leave it there. We thank you very much for your time. Security analyst Charles Shoebridge, thank you.